Thank you, everyone. Moving ahead for the same panel discussion on addressing vaccine hesitancy in India, I would now request Dr. Purva to kindly further proceed for the discussion again.
This session is sponsored by JSI India and ITSU. The session is on addressing vaccine hesitancy in India. We have a panel of five members. I would request them all to please come on the dais. Dr. Naveen Thakkar, Ms. Reena Day, Ms. Jimli Barua, Dr. Prem Singh, and Dr. Preetu Dhalaria. Dr. Prem Singh is a public health specialist and has more than 15 years of public health experience in program operations at various levels. He has a specialized experience in immunization system strengthening, new vaccine introduction, monitoring and evaluation, action research, cold chain and vaccine supply chain, communication and VPD surveillance. He is currently leading new vaccine introduction and immunization systems team at ITSU Immunization Technical Support Unit. He has also worked with UNICEF India in Nigeria country office and led monitoring and evaluation of routine immunization and polio nationally for both Nigeria and India. He has also worked with leading UN agencies, including WHO, UNICEF, UNDP, PATH, and GSI. I would now request him to please come moderate the session and introduce our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you, Apurva. Good afternoon, everyone. And I take this opportunity to welcome you all for this panel discussion on a very important topic of vaccine hesitancy. Sure. So you know, recently this vaccine hesitancy has been figured out in WHO identified list of top 10 threats for the global health. And also recently we have observed a lot of outbreaks globally, not only in developing worlds, but also in developed world related to vaccine preventable diseases. So we are now seeing outbreaks in America, the measles and diphtheria outbreak in Europe, and the main contributor is this vaccine hesitancy which is creeping up in the world. Then also I want to share that as per the NFHS4, our full immunization coverage of India is 62% for 2015-16. Lots of effort has been done through Mission Indradhanush, intensified Mission Indradhanush, and recent sub-national level evaluated coverage have showed that there is around 18.5 percent point increase in these areas where all these efforts have been done. But now, if we maybe say that we are close to 70-75%, but reaching 90% target, which PM, the Prime Minister of India, have given us, is tough, because unless we address these pockets, special pockets where we are having this vaccine hesitancy, we'll not be able to reach 90%. So we will discuss this important aspect, and in our panel we have these esteemed guests. I'd like to introduce first Dr. Naveen Thakkar. He is a well-known child specialist of Gandhidham and a director of Deep Children Hospital and Research Center at Gandhigram, Kutch, Gujarat, and also Professor of Pediatrics at Pramukh Swami Medical College in Gujarat, India. He is member of various associations and group. Recently has been elected as the Executive Director of International Pediatric Association for 2019-21. He was the President of Asia-Pacific Pediatric Association in 2016-18. He was National President of Indian Academy of Pediatrics in 2007. He's also member of Indian Expert Advisory Group on Measles and Rubella. He's member of Pneumococcal Expert Group of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. He's also a member of Immunization Action Group. He's member of Indian Expert Group on Polio. So many these groups and organization is the leading member. And he's among the top influencer for the fight against polio released by UNICEF on World Polio Day in 2017, along with a lot of others like Amitabh Bachchan and many. And he has also received very prestigious award of Outstanding Asian Pediatrician Award in 2012, Rotary International Regional Award in 2010, I'll also like to introduce another guest, Ms. Reena Day. She is the Director of Communication in Core Group India. She has more than 25 years of experience in program communication for immunization program, for polio, for maternal child health, HIV/AIDS. Her main interest lies on building capacity of field worker on behavior change communication using low or no cost communication tools. She has immense experience of working at the ground level, especially for the communication and social mobilization network, and especially in vaccine hesitant pocket like Western UP and Bihar. She is also one of the major contributor in making India polio free. So I welcome her. Our another guest, the panelist is Dr. Preetu Dalaria. We have already introduced him. He's Director of Immunization Technical Support Unit. And Jhimli Barua, she is a lead of strategic communication in ITSU, and she is supporting the Government of India in communication-related activities for immunization campaigns and routine immunization. So thank you all. We welcome you all for this important session. So now I'd like to begin with you, sir, Dr. Naveen Thakkar, sir, to start with this discussion to know what is the vaccine hesitancy, how we define vaccine hesitancy, how WHO is defining it.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to speak before you. My son is a student of community medicine. The vaccine hesitancy, you know, if we say the official or, you know, definition, WHO SAGE working group in 2013 defined vaccine hesitancy as reluctance or, you know, in spite of availability of vaccination services or vaccine, reluctance or refusal or delaying the taking the vaccine. So that's a official, whatever definition is available. But many people, they don't want to call it vaccine hesitancy. They say it's a negative term. So they will talk about vaccine confidence, which is a positive term. Then nowadays, they still people, say that if you say vaccine hesitancy, it may, you know, you may increase this. So they talk about vaccine demand. So these are the terms which are used in combination. And as I said, WHO SAGE working group in 2013, this behavior of not taking vaccines or delaying it or refusing it, it attributed to few factors. And they called it 3C model, you know, to understand vaccine hesitancy: complacency, confidence, and convenience. So this is called 3C model, and then people have proposed different models like 5C model, 5A model, where they have also talked about other things. We must understand, even if vaccine hesitancy is suspected, refusal is suspected, we must look for if there are any access issues. That's why they have included this in, you know, these models. We also, depending on these models, a lot of work is going on that how to measure the vaccine hesitancy. You cannot do something if you don't measure it. And for measuring vaccine hesitancy, depending on these models, there are different index: vaccine safety index, vaccine confidence index, 5C of psychological antecedent of the vaccine behavior. This is not possible to cover here, but this is all very recently, a recent paper by Cornelia Belch from Germany has outlined all these models and how to measure that. So this is vaccine hesitancy, which is, you know, becoming a really global threat, not only to the global health, but also global health security is considering, because this has, this can spill over to the other preventive behavior. So this is very, very important. It's not only question of hesitancy, but as a whole of the preventive health behavior.
Thank you, sir. Just in addition, like, who are these vaccine hesitant? Like, who are these people, who are these group?
Yeah, so actually, to call it a group, you know, if you say vaccine hesitant and anti-vaccines are same? No. Anti-vaxxers are a very tiny group or people who are determined to oppose vaccine acceptance because of their vested interest. And we, our target is are not on those groups because they, we are not going to change it. We are talking about the vaccine people who have doubts about vaccine, who are reluctant to take vaccines, and these are well-meaning individuals. They are concerned about their children's health. But as the patients are becoming consumers, parents are becoming hyper-vigilant because of information overload. They have some doubts, and we have to target this group, and we will discuss more how to do that. But this is, you know, there is a wide spectrum from denying for a particular vaccine, for denying for all the vaccines or taking some vaccines. So there is a whole spectrum from zero to the full acceptance. And we must understand the behaviors of, you know, what are the drivers of vaccine behavior in order to address this issue.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Pitu, Dr. Naveen Thakkar has clearly defined vaccine hesitancy, who are this group. Just to add, like, can you tell us what are the determinants of vaccine hesitancy, why it's now creeping up, coming up as a challenge?
Anyways, fine. I think I will speak loudly. So, majorly, if we see, I mean, the determinants for vaccine hesitancy, we can group them in basically in three groups. Number one is the consensual influences, which includes, I mean, the socio-economic culture and the health system factors which are there. Second, I think, is individual and group influences, basically, including those arising from the personal perception of a vaccine. So what Dr. Thakkar was just saying, that there's a perception of particular vaccine in the mind of people. And third is the vaccine or vaccination specific issues, including the individual assessment of risk and benefit and the effect of mode of administration basically is the problem. Oral is fine, but when we are coming to injectable, then there is a problem. We faced a lot of issues during the MR campaign. There were WhatsApp messages going on basically and spreading this. And we experienced that during the polio drives also. So basically, these are the three major groups where we can classify the hesitancy.
Great. Thank you, sir. I'll ask Jimli. Can you tell, like, because vaccine hesitancy, whether there is a difference in hesitancy during campaigns or a vaccine hesitancy during routine immunization? Because routine immunization are regular sessions, and campaign may be acute phase of some crisis or hesitancy. Can you please...
Thank you for your question, Dr. Prem. When we see there is a underlying feeling of hesitancy or a tendency of hesitancy, whether it's in the routine immunization immunization sessions being undertaken or whether it's in a campaign, we see that across. But what we see what we have been seeing in recent times is that the level of hesitancy tends to escalate when it comes to campaigns, because there's something about campaigns which is very urgent, which is very time bound, and which is just now, and there's a target attached to campaigns. So everything in a campaign is almost always on a hurried mode. So somewhere what is important when it comes to, and we see that that tends to somewhere exacerbate the level of fear, the level of anxiety, the fear of worry of side effects, all of that together combines and becomes one big kind of a reason for reluctance of hesitancy among parents. What is very important to do in these kind of situations is basically to prepare, and preparation is the key, because before a campaign begins, it is very important that we tell the community what is it for, what we are aiming at, and what are the benefits of this vaccine, why are we even doing it on a campaign mode. So once we are able to make people aware of these kind of information, as well as the scientific benefits of the vaccine, I think there is then much more, response or much more acceptance of the vaccines.
Okay, and for routine immunization, it's different or...
Yeah, but the same mode is also required for determination. But here, at least we have the one in the routine. We have the luxury of the time to prepare, also to communicate. Because and there also in both the modes, whether it's in the campaign mode or whether it's in the routine mode, it is important to adopt a multi-faceted approach or a multi-strategic mode. To appeal to people using various modes of communication, whether it's mass media, whether it's interpersonal communication, whether using social media, various forms of mediums needs to be used to reach out to the people and to convince them and to give them the confidence that the vaccine is for the larger good of the community.
Great, thank you. Dr. Preetu, you are working with Government of India very closely on all these things. So can you tell us Indian context of this threat, like whether it's a huge threat for India and which areas of the country are facing it, this problem?
It is not India. Hesitancy is becoming a problem worldwide now. Even US is also worried. There are a lot of news which is coming up that there is a, in US also people are hesitating to get their children vaccinated. In India, I think because of this certain determinants which I briefed just now, there is a disparity in coverages. It is not between the states, two states, not between even within these, within the state, not within the state, within the district. If you see the within the district, within the blocks, and even within the villages. Like for instance, if I take example of Haryana, Haryana FIC, their fully immunization coverage is about 62%, right? And the Mewat area in Haryana, the FIC is 13%. And on the other side, the Ambala is like 97%. So these are the, these are the threats. If we don't address them, these pockets actually pull down the coverage, and that's the reason if we don't address that hesitancy, we won't be able to reach that 90% goal, which is set by our Prime Minister.
Thank you, Dr. Preetu. Reena, you have worked a lot on polio program and especially deal with this hesitancy related to polio. So just want to know, like, how world is dealing with this vaccine hesitancy and what is the best possible way out to deal with it?
Thank you. First of all, before I comment on your question, I would like to say all the women over here, happy Women's Day. And also to all the women in our country who really support in our immunization program. So hats off to you. Thank you, Preetu. I think, worldwide, or you look at countrywide, as well as in India, I think the way we have dealt in polio, I think we should take that learnings from polio and try to apply it in our routine immunization. And before I get into that detail, when we say routine immunization, it becomes routine. So I think we should shift our vocabulary also from routine to essential immunization. That's another thing, something at the policy level, if we can, address too. But of course, I think if we can make our communication organic. When I say organic, means very simple, direct, and easy to understand for any community members anywhere across the world. And that has really proven very useful when we talk to our community level, at the village level, or at the district level, state level, or even at the national level. So at various level, we have to identify these various stakeholders who are dealing with communication issues related to immunization, whether it's religious leaders, or it's politicians, or it's community leaders at the village level. So if we can make them understand the science of polio, which we have done it very successfully in polio eradication, if we can make them understand the science of immunization, why we are immunizing a child at certain intervals, I think the dropout rates will increase. Because what we are giving at the moment is, this immunization is important for you, but we are not giving this complete information about this, why it is given at this interval and why you should come back at after 1.5 months or whatever duration of the immunization. I think these are two very important, and involvement of all the stakeholders, whether it's development partners or it's stakeholders, including religious leaders or community leaders, is a must now. And it's very much essential. Otherwise, community ownership, partnership doesn't exist. So that's something very important. Right. Thank you.
And you have worked a lot on social mobilization network. CORE is working on it. So can you tell what role they have played in dealing with this vaccine hesitancy issues, maybe in polio or routine immunization? Can you share that?
Okay. So before I talk about social mobilization network, I'm sure some of you must be aware of that UNICEF and organization like CORE Group and Rotary International has set up a network called Social Mobilization Network for polio eradication in selected states as well as selected districts of our country like UP, Bihar, West Bengal, etc. So there we have hired these mobilizers from the same community, and they were trained. They were trained not just giving a brief about polio, but a brief about what behavioral aspect they should be working on and how to deal with it. So the training which was given to these mobilizers were of high and super high quality. And if you have seen some of these mobilizers, you would know why they are different. So when it comes to dealing with vaccine hesitancy under SMNet, that is Social Mobilization Network, they go house to house and really spend some quality time with the community members. And here it's not only just women. Here we go and talk to the male members also, who are the decision maker at the family level. So when it comes to collectively deciding on immunization, it's very important that we involve the family, not only just the mother. So that has been very successful in SMNet that we have done. And also the supervisory level, which we have done very successfully in polio. Similarly, in SMNet also, it's not that mobilizers are left alone. They are volunteers. They are only giving their time and they are paid very minimal amount. But they are supervised, and supervised means supportive supervision is given to them. So which motivates them. We have also celebrated their contribution time to time. I think we really need to celebrate the contribution of our ANMs, of our ASHAs, so that they also feel motivated to their work.
Yeah, and moreover, I think learning from polio is good. But during the polio, there was some like the use of social media. During that time, I think we were evolving through that, and it was not that much of threat. But nowadays, it's equally, I mean, it's a threat also, it's a useful also. Threat like, you know, the we have seen in MR. And the WhatsApp has really created damage to MR campaign in South. So using, I mean, judicially, and see that how effectively we can use the social media is becoming a challenge nowadays, because it can give you benefits. It can spoil your program also.
Just want to add to it that when we say that how we are going to handle the vaccine hesitancy, it's very important that every level we got to listen what are the hesitancy, the type of hesitancy is there. So to be a good listener is something also, is also to be a good communicator. I think polio program has really given us that skill, what to listen, when to listen, and how to listen.
Great. That is really a great learning from polio program. Dr. Naveen, especially we had last session on how the medical role in dealing with like improving immunization coverage. And vaccine hesitancy itself is now an issue. So how do you think the pediatrician or the medical fraternity or medical colleges can support in this?
So before that, it's very important to understand that human mind and nature is very complicated. We have our own beliefs, we have our own values, and then in this social context, you know, what others are doing, that influences us a lot. When it comes to rationalize, instead of understanding it rational, we try to rationalize. We use our heart more than our head. And this is also seen that only education and information doesn't work. And also debunking doesn't work. If you do debunking, that has a miss backfire effect. So considering all this, what works? It is seen that the key word is trust. Trust in vaccine, trust in medical professionals are still a trusted voice. It has been seen that a clear-cut recommendation from a medical professional, pediatrician or any medical professional, is a driver of the vaccine acceptance. But we have never been taught in the behavior-centered communication techniques. Fortunately, we have RENA and we have SM network in UP, but not everywhere. Everyone is not taught. This is never taught. And we as a doctors, medical professional, are very poor communicator. So we have to learn behavior-centered communication technique. One example is like motivational interviewing. Listening, you know what she said. We have to learn to first change our behavior, try to listen to the parents, what are their concerns. And let me tell you, the routine survey, what we do, what are the reasons why your child is not vaccinated, and they say, okay, it was not convenient, time was not suitable, or fear of AEFI. We have to go beyond that and use behavioral scientists and involve them and see what is behind that. Many a times, the parents also, they don't know why they are saying that, but we have to do a deep dive and understand. So this medical professional and medical colleges have huge pool of resources, you know, medical students, doctors, nurses, paramedicals. Everyone is to be taught a behavior-centered communication technique where you listen and then you sort it out, as you know, SM network is doing in UP. Every medical professional should be trained in that. There is a lot of work going on at global level. There is through International Pediatric Association, we have designed a program where we are teaching the medical professional. Recently, we had a TOT, Prem was also there. People came from 22 countries. There is a IPCI, Interpersonal Communication for Immunization at Global Level by UNICEF, is moderating a hub. So there is a lot of work going on. As I said, this is the high time everyone come together and medical colleges as a unit at the regional or district level take the lead, involve everyone to use these techniques, involve behavioral scientists, analyze what is going on and address. See, only if you, Reena, if you only improve the knowledge about the science, that may take up from the 60 to 75%. But if you say 80%, but if you want to reach to the last child, then you will have to learn these techniques and everyone has to, understand what's going on. Because Mission Indradhanush, Preetu said, how many types of MI has been done? But now what is coming out, whatever is remaining are vaccine hesitant. It's not access issue. It's not another issue. There are some deep rooted issues which we have to understand. So we have, all of us have a very important role to play.
Great, sir. Thank you so much. My last question to Dr. Preetu, because he's working very closely with GOI. So what initiative Government of India is taking to address this issue?
I think Dr. Prem, Government of India has recognized that this is the issue which they need to address. If they don't address this issue, then probably the target to reach that 90% and beyond may not be possible. Though we have a roadmap now set and for to reach 90%, but more important in that is to address the hesitancy. So Government of India has commissioned ITSU to carry out a basically implementation pilot. So what we are trying to do in this is that we have selected four pockets in the country. And if you see these pockets, one is Mewat, and another is Bhiwandi, and then Muzaffarnagar in UP, and then Sivai Madhopur in Rajasthan, basically where the tribal population there. We have, studied the various methods of addressing the hesitancy in different settings. Internationally also and nationwide also. So we had compiled like 10 different kind of strategies which can be applied in the community to address this hesitancy. Government of India want to know that, in what area they want to divert their funding through PIP to address the hesitancy in that area. So this pilot basically is going to, what we are going to try to do is first to understand the magnitude of problem and then see what is the best method or best strategy out of this 10, maybe two or three can best work in that kind of a setting. Because the hesitancy problem in Mewat is something different and cannot be same in Savai Madhepur, because there's a tribal area. So we need to have certain strategies which we need to test. So this pilot is going to be for 1 year, and in the beginning, I think 2 months we'll spend for pre-assessment, and then 2 months for post-assessment, and 8 months of program implementation. Probably this is going to guide Government of India to divert its funding through PIP to address this vaccine hesitancy in the country.
Thank you, sir. We have already cut short our few questions. Just to give you opportunity to ask, we will take only 2 questions because of positive time. So, questions? Yeah, please, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. There is no question. I thank Ms. Reena Day. Madam, I will remember you every day from today. Because women are great, really great. And they need to be rewarded. This is what we did. We awarded and we rewarded 50 women who brought their children right on due date that is written. This is because of Government of India again, because they have modified their immunization card due date, and they vaccinated. Can you believe they are bringing, anybody can check what I am telling in my medical college, they are bringing exactly 5th means 5th on that day itself. So hats off to her. Name of the baby is Lasya. You can get this in the internet. UVAC baby. We coined a new word also. EU Thermia U Genetics, like that. UVAC baby, which is vaccinated as per the schedule, very close to the schedule, and completed timely. And so 50. That's all. Thanks to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Last
question.
Yes.
Coverage may be more than 95%. Whereas some of the underperforming states, some of the districts, they are also doing excellent. Then why they are doing excellence? So we have to really apply or implement that particular model to those districts or to those states where they are underperforming, rather than blaming the community or blaming the beneficiary.
So this pilot, actually, we will be studying the control also.
You know, that's similar to understand that what is working, what is not working. We'll do that. Thank you, sir.
Just want to.
Thank you.
Sorry, yeah.
Hesitancy by the ANMs,
EHS. Yeah, I was just going to say that it's not only just the community.
It's very easy to blame the community, but it does our health fraternity also believe in immunization or not? Something that needs to be really relooked.
If
they believe in the program, are they giving correct information to the community or not? Timely immunization is something that we are really missing out.
If you blame the community, you will never succeed. You have to understand if there are any concerns.
Great. So we conclude this session now. And thanks to all of you, and thanks to our panelists. A round of applause for them.
Here I want to say something. I want to personally thank Dr. Prutu Dalaria, so for sponsoring this session. Hum bahut inko 99 se jante hain, ye Himachal ko belong karte hain, district mandi se. To humne inko bola bhi, aap to humko kam paisa de rahe hain. To humne phir inke koi Soni sahab baat karte the humse, main kaha unse baat karaiye Prutu sahab, main kaha wo humko jante hain, 99 se Surat se jante hain. Inhone Vikas Desai ko wahan president banaya tha, jitaya tha. तो हमको भी जताया था वहाँ जीसी मेंबर. तो पर्सनली आई वांट टू थैंक हिम फॉर इनहांसिंग आवर बजट. सो वी आर वेरी थैंकफुल टू हर. थैंक यू. सो नाउ आई विल नाम पहला. सो नाउ आई विल रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर मधु गुप्ता कम ऑन स्टेज एंड फेलिसिटेट Dr. Prem Singh. Next, I want to invite Dr. Muhammad Salim Khan. He's here. Doctor, I invite Dr. S.R. Majda. है कि नहीं होगी डॉक्टर एसवा मास्टर आइए आइए एंड फेलिस्ट्रेट डॉक्टर नवीन ठक्कर तीसरा कौन है मेरे को आगे बढ़ा So now, I have the honor to invite our compeer, Dr. Nidhi Chauhan, to felicitate Miss Reena. अब कौन बचा है? लाऊंगा इसको। नहीं बंदी बंदी। हो गया। ये कौन सा बचा? ये? So I now I invite Dr. Anupam Parashar. Is she here? Yeah. To felicitate.
Oh, Hidimba Temple.
Jimli.
Wow. ये मनाली में। सही है।
सारे हो गए
स्लेट
हो गया
वेरी नाइस
बोला ना
मिस जिमली आई रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर अनुपम पराशर टू काइंडली फेलिसिटेट मिस जिमली बरवा
So now we are done away with the scientific sessions. So now I invite Dr. A.M. Kadri, Dr. Anil J. Purti, and other functionaries of IAPSM headquarters on stage to conduct general body meeting. Dr. Purti.
active members, our supporters, they'll help us to take attendance.